Although the previous film in the series, Friday the 13th, A New Beginning, had been a financial success, it had disappointed the series fans and received some of the worst reviews of any film in the series. In order to prevent further alienating the fans, the producers decided to take the series in a new direction, moving it away from what producer Frank Mancuso Jr. called the coarse nature of A New Beginning. To this end, Mancuso hired Tom McLaughlin, who had directed the successful horror film One Dark Night, but was also known around Hollywood for shopping around various comedy scripts he had written. McLaughlin was given free rein on how he would present the story, with the only condition being that he bring back Jason and make him the film's villain. McLaughlin decided to take the film in the direction of an old Universal Monsters movie, specifically the 1931 version of Frankenstein, which portrayed the monster as a lumbering killer brought to life by electricity. McLaughlin also drew from vampire lore in order to give Jason a weakness, namely being returned to his home soil. To achieve this, McLaughlin disregarded the idea presented in Part 2 that Jason had survived his drowning, instead presenting the idea that Jason had always been some sort of supernatural force. He also decided to retcon the ending of the fifth film, where Tommy Jarvis was a serial killer. In fact, Pam's truck from the fifth film can be seen indicating she is alive. McLaughlin further decided to expand the series' thematic scope, incorporating action film elements and postmodern meta-humor. When Jason is first encountered in the woods near Crystal Lake, the character Lisbeth comments that she and Darren should flee because she knows about proper conduct to survive a horror film. McLaughlin would further satirize the series itself, as Martin the Gravedigger comments on Jason's grave, why did they have to go and dig up Jason, before breaking the fourth wall and addressing the camera with the observation, some folks sure got a strange idea of entertainment. In addition to Frankenstein, McLaughlin also cited as inspiration his love of gothic horror, particularly the works of Edgar Allan Poe and his Catholic upbringing. Jason Lives features the series' only explicit reference to God, and during the climax, a praying girl is spared by Jason. The decision to retcon the events of Part 5 resulted in many members of the film's cast, whose characters had survived, having their contracts to return for a sequel terminated. The surviving characters Pam and Reggie from A New Beginning were to have died in the film's opening moments. Shavar Ross, who played Reggie in A New Beginning, said he wasn't interested in coming back just to be killed off. John Shepard was initially asked to reprise his role as Tommy Jarvis from the previous film. Shepard, a born-again Christian, had reservations about returning to the series. He ultimately decided to film Caught, and shortly thereafter retired from acting. Tom Matthews, who would take over the mantle of Tommy Jarvis, was chosen for his work in the horror comedy Return of the Living Dead. Although Mancuso Jr. retained control over the film's casting, he deferred to McLaughlin's judgment. The only caveat was that the final girl had to be a very attractive blonde. To fulfill this requirement, McLaughlin chose Jennifer Cook, based on her performance in the television series V. The role of Hawes, Tommy's would-be sidekick who dies within the first 5 minutes of the movie, was given to another television veteran, Ron Palillo, famous for the role of Horseshack on Welcome Back, Kotter. David Kagan, who was also an acting teacher for female lead Jennifer Cook, was cast as Sheriff Mike Garris. Jason's first female victim in the film, Lisbeth, was played by McLaughlin's wife, Nancy. Tony Goldwyn would make his film debut playing Darren. Tony would go on to star in Ghost. Tom Fridley, who was John Travolta's nephew, was cast as Court. Darcy DeMoss was cast as Nikki. Renee Jones was cast as Sissy Baker. Carrie Noonan was cast as Paula. Bob Larkin would be cast as Martin. Ted White, who played Jason in Friday the 13th, The Final Chapter, was offered the opportunity to return to the role, but he turned down the role. White stated in hindsight he should have accepted the offer. In keeping with the series tradition, the role of Jason was given to a stuntman, Dan Bradley. Bradley, however, was fired for being too fat. Although the scenes that Bradley filmed, in which Jason kills the paintball plane executives, were kept in the completed picture, the rest of Jason's scenes were performed by C.J. Graham, an area restaurant manager and a former soldier. The film's music was composed by Harry Manfredini, who composed the scores to all the series' previous installments. In addition to the original score, the soundtrack also featured 3 songs from Alice Cooper, He's Back, The Man Behind the Mask, Teenage Frankenstein, and Hard Rock Summer. He's Back, The Man Behind the Mask had an accompanying music video, combining clips from the film with new footage featuring Alice Cooper. It is not present on any home video release of the film, but may be viewed on YouTube. In order to keep the film's storyline a secret, the production was given the fake title Aladdin Sane, both as a pun, a lad insane referencing the storyline of a mental patient pursued by a killer, and in keeping with the series' tradition of using David Bowie song album titles as fake names. The original script contained material that alluded to Jason's father, which to date remains the closest the series has ever come to shedding some light on the mysterious character. In the script, Pamela's headstone is next to Jason's, a reference to the fact that someone paid to have Jason buried, explaining why he was not cremated as the mayor said in Friday the 13th, A New Beginning. As well as this, there is a final scene in which Jason's father visits his son's grave, seemingly aware of the fact that Jason is not inside it. These scenes were never filmed, but it made it to the film's novelization. The 2009 Deluxe Edition DVD used the storyboard art and voiceover work to complete the scene. The film's producers requested that McLachlan add additional gore, violence, and murders to the film. The original cut of the film contained 13 killings as an in-joke. In order to appease the studio, McLachlan had to add an additional 3 killings, bringing the total up to 16. These were the killings of Martin the Gravedigger and the recently engaged couple on a nighttime picnic. Additionally, McLachlan was made to extend Sissy's death, adding to the shots of Jason dragging her to the ground and twisting her head off, as originally filmed. Sissy was simply pulled out of the cabin window and wasn't seen again until Megan finds her head in the squad car. McLachlan also found himself in contention with the producers over how the film should end. In the original script, the movie was supposed to have concluded in the graveyard with Martin the Gravedigger meeting Jason's father, Elias. McLachlan ultimately shot 3 endings, 2 of which, against his expectations, were not included on the film's DVD release. In one ending, Jason's mask floats to the surface of Crystal Lake, having become detached during his struggle with Megan. In another, Deputy Cologne was seen trying to reach the jail cell keys after having been locked in by Tommy and Megan. The door to the police station opens and the film abruptly ends, indicating that Jason had managed to get free. The producers disliked both of these endings, as each one left Jason's survival ambiguous, and wanted it explicitly shown on screen that he was still capable of returning for a sequel. As a result, McLachlan shot the film's current ending, showing a close-up of Jason's open, twitching eye. The ending scene in which Megan attacks Jason with the outboard motor was actually filmed in 3 different locations. The underwater shots were filmed in a temperature-controlled tank in Los Angeles, the above-water shots were filmed in a murky Georgia lake, and the shots of the motor actually cutting Jason's mask were filmed in Tom McLachlan's father's swimming pool, actually ruining the pool filter in the process. One of the TV ads for this movie featured the following: Friday the 13th Part 6, Jason Lives, Nothing This Evil Ever Dies, perhaps in an attempt to explain in a nutshell how Jason keeps coming back from the dead. This film marks the only time in the series that there are actually children at the summer camp. Tom McLachlan took home some props from the film, including Jason's tombstone, which sits outside his house, made to look like Jason is buried in his yard, and his casket, which sits in his garage. McLachlan was actually offered the chance to direct Scream in the mid-90s. The gig Wes Craven eventually accepted. He declined, but during that process he met Kevin Williamson, who admitted that the fantastically self-aware Part 6 was an influential film for him on the path to eventually writing Scream. Friday the 13th, Part 6, Jason Lives was filmed at Camp Daniel Morgan in Covington, Georgia, a suburb around 30 minutes outside of Atlanta. Friday the 13th, Part 6, Jason Lives opened on August 1st, 1986. It grossed over $6.7 million its opening weekend. Ultimately, it would go on to gross a total of $19.4 million at the US box office. With a budget of $3 million, marking the first time that a Friday the 13th installment did not gross over $20 million and beginning the general decline in box office returns. This is the first film in the series which did not place first at the United States box office during its opening weekend. The film was the first in the film series to receive favorable movie reviews since the original. Variety described the film as predictable, but reasonably slick. And Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune called it the least offensive film of the most offensive film series ever. Friday the 13th, Part 6 was released on VHS on September 28, 1994, and on DVD on September 25, 2001, and on Deluxe Edition DVD and Blu-ray on June 16, 2009. And featured in the book Crystal Lake Memories, released in November 2005, as well as the DVD and Blu-ray versions of the book released on September 13, 2013, as well as the complete box set of Friday the 13th. and featured in the game Friday the 13th, the game, released on May 26, 2017. I hope you've enjoyed this brief look at Friday the 13th, Part 6, Jason Lives. Join me next time as we take a brief look at Part 7, The New Blood.